Look inside, girl, let the sound take you away.
Hello, San Diego Comic-Con! Super excited to be here with you all after 3 years of no Comic-Con. Back in Hall H to kick off the year. And what better way to kick it off than with such an awesome franchise, Dungeons & Dragons. It's something so near and dear to my heart, and I'm sure the same goes for you guys. Today we're gonna have some awesome conversations with some of the guys behind the movies, as well as the incredible cast. But remember, anything you guys see here is just for you guys at Hall H. So, yep, please don't record. I know you already said it, but now I'm saying it also. So now, no take backs. Is everybody ready to get started? Let's kick off with a quick behind the scenes look with the cast and filmmakers of Dungeons & Dragons Honor Among Thieves. How awesome was that? Well, I don't want to waste any more time. Let's get into this. I want to get you guys in contact with the filmmakers. First, let's bring up one of the producers of the film, a filmmaker behind a handful of movies you may have heard of before. Iron Man, The Avengers, Guardians of the Galaxy, Spider-Man Homecoming. Give it up for Jeremy Latcham.
Doing? Dude, I am doing so well to be standing on this stage. It's awesome to be back at Comic-Con. And I feel like I grew up at Comic-Con. Like, I've been coming to Comic-Con for so long, since the very first Iron Man 1 presentation. And to be here with something like this, that's something totally, like, brand new, it's like, it's crazy, guys. It's exciting.
How about we get some people up here with you? How does it look?
Absolutely.
Awesome. Next. Please welcome the film's directing and screenwriting duo. They've written Horrible Bosses, Spider-Man Homecoming, and directed Game Night. Here's Jonathan Goldstein and John Francis Daly. Feeling
so good, guys. I love you guys. Thank you so much for coming out here,
guys. We have been in the trenches with COVID and making this movie for 2 years, and to see your faces is so thrilling for us because it reminds us why we do this. Thank you for being here.
Really appreciate it.
Well, let's get into it. Let's start with Jeremy. Can you tell everyone about the genesis of the project? What appealed to you about it, and how much did you know about the world of D&D coming into the film?
So I had worked with John and Jonathan on a movie that I love called Spider-Man Homecoming that these guys had written. And to me, there's this sense of heart and humor and spectacle and this ability to balance tone, and that is what makes these kind of movies to me work. Is this like tonal balance between thrilling and exciting and heartfelt, and you want to cry and you want, anyways. I knew they could do all of that, and I was so excited to find out that they were on this. And when they called me and the studios called, and everyone was like, we want to make a D&D movie and launch something totally new, and it's with Jonathan and John, I was like, all right, I am 1,000% in, and it's been a journey since that phone call of nonstop work for 2 years, 2.5 years. Did not stop the whole time.
Not at all.
Very fun.
John?
Both of us have a long history with D&D. We should start with that. I played as a kid, the first edition, and I would play, my older brother was the dungeon master, and he would always kill me off in the first half hour. Whatever I did, I'd end up in a gelatinous cube. Just, there was no saving me.
Jonathan was Elliot in E.T., basically.
That's right. And now my 10-year-old son plays every week. He's here today. Samson, where are you? Say hello. There he is.
I had been an avid player since I was 14 years old when I was an actor on the show Freaks and Geeks. And, oh, thank you. Thanks a lot. And my character was a geek, and he was a huge fan of Dungeons & Dragons. I had known peripherally about it, so I decided, being the young method actor that I was, to play a campaign with the fellow cast members. And immediately I fell in love with the world, because as you guys know, anyone who plays Dungeons & Dragons is not just a game. It is really the feeling that you get when you play the game, and that really is what we tried to do here with this film. That sense of camaraderie, family, coming together as a group, facing obstacles that you don't know what to expect. I mean, so many things that, you know, much to the chagrin of the DM, doesn't know what's gonna happen. And so that is what we wanted to capture. And of course, that very unique brand of humor that I think sets us apart from anything else in the fantasy space. So it was a real excitement for us.
Awesome. So since all of you guys are D&D fans, I have to ask, and more just broadly movie fans, what in the film are you most excited to share with the audience?
Well, for me, it's the chance to bring to life these creatures, these places, these people that we've only been able to sort of imagine in our heads, and to give solid matter to that. I mean, it's such a thrill. You're going to see things today, and then eventually when the movie comes out, that, you know, you've been playing or hearing about or imagining for years. And now that we have the visual effects technology and also practical effects in the movie, we're able to bring those to life, and that's just so exciting to us.
Yeah, we have the geniuses at Legacy Effects doing all of our creatures and animatronics. It's really important for us to do a real fusion of practical and visual effects. So we have the top visual effects companies doing it, ILM and MPC, and Legacy, who gave you Baby Yoda. So what more can you ask for?
Grogu.
I missed that. What did you say?
That's Grogu.
No, I think for me, the thing that is the theme that I think always binds us when we watch a movie is this sense of family, of found family, of finding like this group of people and kind of connecting with them, and like that's what makes Guardians Guardians. That's what makes the Avengers the Avengers. And I think you look at like these groups that come together and the personalities clash and they face a giant obstacle, and then they have to kind of become a family over the course of it. I know it sounds like kind of, you know, but I'm a very emotional guy, so it is kind of just the thing I love the most. And what this journey has is really that, because these folks don't really all belong together, and they learn to love each other, and I feel like I've fallen completely in love with this cast along the way because of it, and it's really, really fun to watch. And that's the thing I'm most excited about the film.
Well, talking about the cast, I think we've waited long enough to bring them on out. Everybody, welcome the cast of Dungeons & Dragons, Honor Among Thieves, starting with Chris Pine. Next up, Michelle Rodriguez. Reggae Jean Page. He's wearing a fantastic jacket. Sophia Lillis. Yeah! And to round it off, Hugh Grant. How are you guys feeling? Excited to be here?
Woo!
Awesome. Well, let's get into it. I'm going to start with you, Chris. Tell us a little bit about what drew you to the film and who you play.
So I wasn't a big D&D-er, but my nephew's, who's now 13 years old, is a huge player, was writing his own campaigns, was playing every week. And in fact, when I talked to John and Jonathan about doing this, they said, let me just send you over like a little gift package of, you know, all things D&D. And I told my nephew about it, and I said, why don't you come on over and we'll open it up together. And to see his eyes when this little treasure chest opened, go from, you know, big to bigger, I knew something was up. And then we decided to get my whole family to play, to do a round of it with his Dungeon Masters. And it was an amazing thing to see all of my family light up in that particular way. And I hadn't seen that happen in my family in years. And from, you know, my father who didn't really want to play, and my sister who thought it was kind of a pain, to how, you know, how it just slowly snowballed and everybody got super stoked on it and really excited. And then 3 hours in, you've completely forgotten that, you know, that you didn't want to 10 minutes before it or whatever. And so, yeah, it was a surprise to me that I hadn't really found it until 42 or whatever. And and I had this, I know, tell me about it. I had this idea. It's like if there's one game, like in high school, I thought to myself, like, that should be played in every single high school or school across the nation, it should be D&D. Because don't you think it's like you can get the bully and the jock, and of course I only speak in John Hughes terms, you know, all in a room, and I guarantee you, in 20 minutes, no one will remember what kind of, you know, class they came from or who their best friends are and who the dork is and all that stuff. They just want to play and have a laugh. And that, I saw that so distinctly and so clearly, it became, I just thought it was such a great world and an energy that I wanted to put out into the world, is to spread the gospel of D&D. All right.
How about you, Michelle?
I mean, I just grew up in Jersey, babe. You don't grow up in Jersey without playing D&D. It's just, you know, what you do. 15, 16, 17 years old. I hadn't played in over 20 years till the boys called me up and said, hey, you into playing a Viking? And I'm like, sure.
Barbarian, but...
Yeah. but yeah, it just brought back all these memories, you know, of being a kid in a basement goofing off with my friends, you know. It's a beautiful experience, and I think role-playing games are awesome, and I think more people Woo! Should do them.
And she kicks ass in this movie.
Boy, that is true.
Yeah, on to you, Reggae.
I've always been D&D adjacent, because I think I came in and I enjoy computer games that do the math for me. But I basically grew up as Eddie Munson. Like, I was picked on at school for being weird and foreign, and I went home and I made angry guitar music, played Chrono Trigger and Diablo, you know what I mean? So I kind of came into it through that way, and so I think that world of... I know a little something about escapist fantasy that gives you no limits, that gives you kind of this big open world of possibility that may not necessarily always be open to you in your real life, but is there the second you get a group of people together. And I find that in a slightly less inspiring way than our leader over here, kind of by the same thing. I've always found role-playing games super inspiring in that way, so that's the way I came in. And I play Paladins my whole life, which is fun.
Hell yeah.
Sophia?
Yeah, hello. I play D&D. I started in high school. I started getting into those D&D podcasts like Critical Role and Adventure Zone, all of that stuff. And it kind of opened up this whole new world, because I started meeting these people in high school who also played D&D, like my teachers and everyone. And I actually left my old school to transfer to a new school halfway through. And right when I left, my old school started a D&D club. So every day after school, I'd take like a 20-minute transit back to my old school and run in and play D&D with my old lab teacher and everyone, and that was one of the most funs I've ever had in high school, and I still think about it to this day, and I still try to get together with my old friends and play another campaign, maybe DM one day, I don't know, but yeah, no, I love D&D.
That's awesome. And here in my notes it says Hugh has always been a lifelong D&D fan, is that?
I think you mixed it up with S&M.
She's not wrong. I've been an enthusiastic dungeon master for some years now. That's a British pastime. National sport, almost. I believe that's why the Jonathans thought of me for this. Yeah, my reputation. But no, what a lovely film to be in. It's really funny, it made me laugh a lot. And what else can I say? How nice to be here, how nice to be Comic-Con.
Believe it or not, this is Hugh's first Comic-Con.
Yes. Thank you.
And next to you,
we did try to come with Sense and Sensibility, but we were turned away.
Yeah, I don't see any cosplayers for Sense and Sensibility out here. What the hell?
Well, hey, let's bring it back to Chris. You are a part of an awesome group of actors. How was it working together during production?
It was a lot of fun. We shot in Northern Ireland, and it was during the UK's lockdown, so there really wasn't much else to do besides work. And so by virtue of that kind of containment, we were our own self-sufficient band of misfits. And set chemistry is a difficult thing, and it's an alchemy that you can only really test as you work and see how it plays. And thank God, I think we all got on well together and passed the time, and that's really what movie making is. It's just a lot of time hanging around and shooting the shit, usually. So we had a great time doing that, honestly. And I think the joy of J&J's script over here, I guess I always kind of call it, it's like a Spielbergian energy to it. It's the films that I grew up with in the 80s. It just feels open and light and buoyant. And your job is to, like good improv, just kind of keep it alive. Keep the energy and the music of the scene alive. And I like that kind of filmmaking, and it makes for a nice energy on set because you're not... you're not trying to fix all of the world's woes with deep sadness or whatever. There's certainly pathos and deep and great emotion in this, but I would say that I guess the word I think of is the kind of the buoyant, kinetic, fun, lively, popping energy to it, and that I think we all glommed onto and really rode with.
Oh yeah. Spielberg. We'll take that comparison.
That's so cool. I think the filmmakers might have a clip that they want to show.
Did you bring the clip?
I thought you did.
We left it at the Abbey.
God. As long as it doesn't start with bah, 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 bah. Like,
on the behind the scenes. That's actually in the movie.
All those technical difficulties out of the way. Just a caveat. This is a very unfinished film still. It's fresh off the Avid, which is an editing device.
Oh, you know that.
You know that. you might see some visual effects that are not still there yet. You are literally the first people to see all this.
And, it doesn't... I don't think it requires too much setup, but essentially our group of campaigners here are trying to find this helmet. And the only way they can do that is to raise some corpses and ask them some questions. So, here's the clip.
So, There was mention of a search for a relic. Can you give us a little bit more about that?
I don't know, can we? Well, they've got this... Jeremy, why don't you answer that?
Is there a red dot on my forehead yet? Tell me when there's the red dot. I know I'm not supposed to say more. No, in the movie, there's a lot of questing in the movie, as you can imagine. And our team is on the search for something that they think will probably solve the issue that they're facing. And we'll find out if it does, right? Am I right? We'll find out.
Is that vague enough for you?
He should be a politician.
That's the exact answer I was looking for. Okay, well, we can take it to the cast then. Based on some of your classes, I'm assuming some of you, like Michelle, who's a barbarian, and Reggae, who's a paladin, had to really prep as warriors. I'd like to hear about that, if you want to start with Michelle.
Yeah, lots of working out, lots of protein shakes, lots of gas. Lots of push-ups, lots of sit-ups, lots of lifting weights. During COVID, you could get lots of frustration, so I kind of got Jeremy to hook me up with a punching bag by my trailer.
That is accurate.
That helped a lot with the stressful days. I had a blast training. I gained about a good 10 pounds of muscle for it. Yeah, it was fun. I really did enjoy, chiseling out the body, It was great.
That's awesome. How about you, Reagan?
I don't know how to follow that answer, Jesus. lots of push-ups, lots of sit-ups, lots of that. I mean, I got to swing a sword around for a living, do you know what I mean? Like, that was just everything that you ever want growing up and coming into this business. I got really, really good with the sword. There was lots and lots of, like, stance training, so, like, my thighs were killing me and I had the best ass of my life.
We can wash clothes on them!
Literally just the best time you could possibly imagine in this job. I spend time training and slaying dragons, you know what I mean? Woo!
And Hugh, obviously you've been involved with many beloved films. I'd like to know what stood out about this one to you in terms of like maybe location and scope.
It was really getting my bottom in shape as well, I think. What was the appeal? Well, I tell you the big appeal. Is that what you just asked? Because I can't hear very well.
Sure.
Is that what you asked me?
Yeah.
What was the appeal?
Yeah.
The appeal was that I found the script incredibly funny. I hate all scripts. I'm notoriously negative. And to my astonishment, I was sent this thing which really made me laugh. I thought it had a real Monty Python vibe to it. Such as the clip you just saw. And I think that was a main thing, and quite a juicy role for me. Nice costumes. I've lived in the UK all my life. I'd never been to Northern Ireland. It was fascinating to go there, and then this amazing cast. You know, I didn't like the directors very much.
It's okay. Feelings mutual.
No, I did. I know.
I love you too.
Beautiful. So in addition to everything you just said, D&D wouldn't be what it is without its awesome and magical monsters. Do any of you guys want to give hints at what we'll get to see from that?
Well, you're going to see some soon. As you know, there's literally a monster manual, and there's hundreds and hundreds to choose from, so we had to make some tough choices, figure out which monsters and creatures would suit the story, which you all would want to see most, and which we could bring to the screen convincingly. And so it was a real conversation, constantly figuring out which we were going to feature. And I think you'll see we have a lot of your favorites, some lesser knowns.
Yeah, and what you will see is not it. We have dozens of monsters and creatures in this movie, and dozens and dozens of spells as well, if that interests anyone. And they are all true to the lore, and it was really fun kind of figuring out what would work best within the context of what we were watching. And
we worked at every step of the way with the Wizards of the Coast, who were an invaluable resource for us from before, when we were writing the script all the way through production to try and make sure that what we were doing was in line with the lore. I think for hardcore fans, hopefully they'll see you know, the reality of the game reflected in there. And for those who don't know the game very well, it's still going to work because it's a fun movie.
Awesome. Well, on that note, we actually do have another early clip, so let's go ahead and check it out. Awesome. At this time, I want to open up to a fan Q&A. If we can go ahead and set that up. In the meantime, I do want to point out, if we can try to keep the questions about the movie specifically. And yeah.
Hey, guys.
Hello.
Oh, hello.
Hey, guys. My name's Sam. My question is for the cast. If right now you guys were all to be sucked into Dungeons & Dragons kind of Jumanji style, what class would you be and why?
What? We can start with you. What class do you think that you would be if you were sucked into Dungeons & Dragons?
The highest class.
We can make our way this way. So if you want, Sophia, if you want to go next.
Oh God. Well, since all of us are actors, I would say Bard, right?
So a universal bard is your answer?
Universal bard. I mean, I've always preferred support classes, just so you can kind of be a little step back from the action, but kind of take all the credit because no one else would survive without you, and support classes do not get enough credit, so I'm going to campaign.
I'd definitely be in the wizard category. I like the idea of being able to disappear and appear whenever the fuck I want to. Excuse my language. I like the sneaky.
Bard, 24/7 bard.
That or like if Leroy Jenkins was a class, that'd be me.
Sure, and then next question.
Hey everyone. Hi Chris, nice to see you again. And my name's Luke. My question is, if you could cross over D&D with one other franchise, what would it be? It's for everyone, the question.
Sense and Sensibility. I mean, does anything beat that?
Foundation. I would mix Dungeons and Dragons with Foundation. Asimov's work. That would be really cool. Sick. D&D in space, bro.
Yeah, but what about Top Gun? Tom Cruise and Wizards.
I'm in for that.
Owlbear is pretty cool.
Sweet.
If there is one universal truth, it's that the party is in need of a healer.
There you go. Before we get to the next question, I want to point out that there's a custom tavern experience from the epic world of Dungeons & Dragons here in the Gas Lamp, which I went to visit last night, and I was curious if any of you guys did.
We did, yeah. Yeah, it was awesome.
It's kind of scary, actually.
Mm-hmm. You get a glow-in-the-dark drink, which you can have with or without alcohol, so there's that.
Oh, wait, I have...
And you can go into the gelatinous cube. I feel like we're not selling the best bits here.
I love the sound system. I'd love to DJ in that sound system. It's pretty sick.
And if you play your cards right, you might be turned into a red wizard.
But only if you
it's
play
possible.
Awesome. Okay, sweet. Next question.
Hello, my name is David. I just had a question if there was any game-specific Easter eggs in the film. I think I saw the cartoon characters walking around. But is there anything else, like maybe someone refers to a Fiend Folio or a deities and demigods in the movie?
There are absolutely a ton of Easter eggs that we loaded in there. Some things that we weren't even aware of that the Wizards of the Coast were helpful enough to help out with. But yeah, if upon multiple watchings, I think you would actually see many of them. Obviously, if I gave them away, though, it wouldn't.
Then there wouldn't be Easter eggs.
An Easter egg, right. It would just be an egg.
In your face.
Awesome. Next question.
Hello, everyone. My name's Nico Holt. To ask my question to the cast and filmmakers, will we get to see any villains relating from the game for this film reboot, like the Beholder, Mind Flayer, or Vecna?
You will see multiple villains, multiple monsters that weren't just in there.
But we'd ruin it if we told you everything.
Yeah. And there are characters from the lore as well that you'll see, so hopefully it'll be satisfying. Gives us enough of a runway to lead into, if we're lucky, multiple films that we can explore many more of these awesome characters.
Sweet, next question.
Hi. Was there any funny moments or funny pranks that happened behind the scenes?
There's one that comes to mind that I think relates to the clip we just saw. When we were shooting Hugh on top of that pillar, there was a moment when he was on top of it, and the line that he says is, "This is much higher than we discussed. Please take me down from here right away." And the special effects gentleman who was operating the lift that Hugh was on top of did not know that was the line of dialogue, and freaked out and started taking the thing apart and taking Hugh down in the middle of the shot. And we had to stop it because obviously he was acting.
He's that good.
I am rather good.
No pranks come to mind, but I do remember one of the biggest challenges was trying to find, we wanted them to go through this wheat or oat field that was not green. And in Northern Ireland, that is way harder than it actually seems. We went on hours and hours of location scouts trying to find a yellow field. And you'd think that wouldn't be that hard, but we finally, after like 12 hours of scouting, found this oat field that we ended up buying acres of oats so that we could film on it. And so if anyone wants oats, I've got...
We own Paramount and E1 own oats now.
That was trying to get rid of the oats.
I don't know if they know that, but they have...
Not for human consumption, though. They're quite old, but if you have a horse...
Well, and we were leading horses through in that scene, and they kept eating the oats, and we had to reshoot that moment, because horses like oats. I don't know if you know that.
Awesome. Love that. Love oats. What, another question?
Yeah, my question's for the whole cast. It seemed like you had a great time shooting this. Would you all be down to do a sequel?
Absolutely.
Let me just say, what I love inherent in that question is a lot of positivity about what this film will do. And so, because that response had so much positive energy, because I can believe that you believe in the power of our Dungeons and Dragons film, I have been given 4 tickets to the Dungeons and Dragons Tavern Experience. It's a first entry situation. And they are yours, my friend.
Sure you don't want oats as well?
We have oats.
And a lifetime supply of oats. Next question.
Hi, I'm Mark from Denmark. I have a question for Reggie.
I'm sorry?
As a paladin from Reggie.
Yep.
Are you staying more lawful or are you going more of a chaotic way?
I mean, I feel like that's a spoiler. Is it not a spoiler? How far into...
Jeremy?
Directors?
I think the choice is very clear once you made the character. And it's... Yeah, no, that's it. It's just very clear.
Sorry, dude.
You're going to get him in trouble. Next question.
Hi, all. Mags here. Hugh, I have a question. What do you think your spirit animal is after doing the movie? And readers at Horse and Hounds appreciate you.
Yeah.
I don't know how to take that.
My spirit animal? I don't know. I suppose I'm a tiger.
Yeah.
It's always been my nickname in the bedroom.
No, mostly in the dungeon.
What did you, and the second part of the question? What
was Horse and Hound.
Oh, Horse and Hound. Yes, yes. Yes. Is there anyone here from Horse and Hound? They generally turn up to most press conferences. Because there are horses in this, right?
And hounds.
And indeed hounds.
Spoiler that's, alert.
That's why we had you in the film.
Yeah.
Next question.
Hi there, my name is Alex, and this question is for the directors and the producer. Do you think, without giving anything away, there's any chance we could see some cameos from some popular faces in the D&D community, like Critical Role, Dimension 20, or Adventure Zone?
There is at least one cameo of a well-known, well-liked D&D player. Beyond that,
I don't think we can say.
We definitely cannot say.
That said, we're huge fans of Critical Role and are so happy that they helped to sort of pave the way to D&D stardom and getting people involved and knowing about it, because I think they've done an incredible job and they've got some awesome material.
And this will be the last question.
Hi, my name is Nate. First, Carl, I'm subbed.
Thank you.
Nice.
You're welcome. And if you could take any item from the set, which one would you take?
Chris took a bunch of things from the set.
I took my horse. I thought your axe was pretty cool.
It was pretty cool. Yeah. I did take that.
Hang on.
Yeah, no. They hooked me up with one.
Oh, got a pretty cool axe. I had a great flute. Flute was cool, although it was never in tune. Made playing it quite difficult. Reggae? Can I say the word?
I don't even know what that is.
Schwartzboard.
Say it.
Schwartzboard.
I would take a dagger sword because it was very, very cool.
Oh yeah, that thing is cool. It lights up and everything. And you can pull off the handle and it's a dagger.
Our friends at Hasbro will have that available for you all.
Dude, by the way, yeah, his outfit I would totally like wear for Halloween. His outfit is sick. Especially if it comes with a sword that pulls out into a dagger and lights up.
You know how I was like checking for spoilers behind your back?
Pretty badass.
Sophia?
I had a slingshot.
Oh yeah. An
arm slingshot thing, which will be a prominent thing. And I like it. I mean, it's a good, I don't know, it wouldn't be very useful in real life. But, you know, I mean, it was fun. And I wore horns in the show.
Magnetic ones that kept falling off.
Yeah, but they were pretty cool. I like those. I don't know. Actually, I wouldn't take those with me. yeah, that's it.
Wait, can I change my answer? Can I take the fish that was covered in KY jelly?
Oh yeah.
No, too late.
Dude, he was pretty sick.
That's in my bedroom.
You.
Well, Hugh, it's a child asking the question. Just keep that in mind.
For many years, I always take home a couple of extras.
Extra costumes, you know.
Yeah, I've got quite a few now, and I, on this one I've got a couple of very pretty extras I'm very, very pleased with. They're in my dungeon now.
You know, the one thing that we were encouraged not to take was the money, because obviously as to Dungeons & Dragons players, the coins are very unique looking, and we created a ton of them, and they're quite authentic, and cost way more than the real money that they represent. And so I think by the end of it, the crew and cast and I collectively stole thousands and thousands of dollars worth of that.
There was none left when we needed it later. There was no coins left. It was outrageous.
And I know a lot of the weapons, the screen used weapons, are actually at the tavern. Is that?
Yeah, there's a few things from the movie at the tavern. Yeah, and a few things from our friends at Legacy Effects that we had on the set. There's a dragon board, which you kind of see the detail and the incredible workmanship and craft work.
Something we haven't really touched on is that we really made an effort to use practical effects as much as digital ones, which is not to take anything away from the geniuses at ILM and MPC and others. It's just that we felt, you know, we love sort of the fantasy movies of the 80s, Neverending Story and all that kind of thing, and we wanted it to have some real physical stuff on set for the actors to interact with.
Which made it much harder to film, by the way, because we had these cutting-edge animatronics and like face capture that would translate to the servos and the facial muscles of some of our creatures, and
that
so...
That poor guy with the fan inside right. of yes. the dragon right. head, that was gnarly.
A lot of overheating actors.
If you watch carefully, in some scenes you can see the guys operating the monsters dressed as people in the scene, so... pretty cool.
I gotta say, that's the coolest part, you know, because after years and years of making these types of movies and technology growing the way that it does, shooting on a green screen with golf balls sucks balls. You know, so having like some real cool, you know, animatronics on set is really helpful. It just makes you really feel like you're part of what's going on, and you get to see the artists, man, do their thing. It's beautiful. It's really cool. Thanks, guys.
All right. Well, I want to give a thanks to the cast. Let's give it up for the cast. The film actors as well. And, of course, the audience that attended tonight.
We should just point out that the son of Gary Gygax, Luke, has honored us with his presence here today. So, Luke, wherever you are, thank you for being here. That's the creator of Dungeons & Dragons.
But before we go, there's one last treat for everyone. We chose you all here at Comic-Con to be the first people we share the trailer with. So here it is, the world debut of the first trailer of Dungeons & Dragons Honor Among Thieves. Awesome. That was Dungeons & Dragons Honor Among Thieves coming out March 3rd, 2023.
Thank you. Thank you all.
Get out.